الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا
الحمد لله الحمد لله خالق الوجود من العدم وجاعل النور من الظلم فمخرج الصبر من الألم وملقي التوبة على الندم فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم للشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم سيد ولد آدم الذي بشر به عيسى بن مريم ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم فالحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا والحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم قل من حرم زينة الله التي أخرج لعباده والطيبات من الرزق قل هي للذين آمنوا في الحياة الدنيا خالصة يوم القيامة كذلك نفصل الآيات لقوم يعلمون رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا اله الا الله واللهم اجعلنا من الذين امنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر امين يا رب العالمين اما بعد Today's khutbah is not going to be about COVID-19 nor is it going to be about the trial that we're going through. We are all aware that we're going through a trial and you know what difficulties there are. We have to remind each other to get through them as best we can. But it's also important to remember that Muslims, even if they're in the midst of the greatest trials, our Prophet would tell us, if you're in the middle of planting a tree, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you complete planting the tree. So life goes on also for a believer. The Quran is a constant for us. Allah describes it as something qayyim, something that stands upright. So whether we're going through difficulty or hardship, Allah says, وَصَابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ. They stand firm and persevere, whether things are getting to the point where they're, you know, in midst of war or any other kind of difficulty. So we have to carry on and not be so overwhelmed by circumstances around us. We do the best we can. We turn to Allah for help. And some people are in more difficulty than we are in. And that's just because Allah Azza wa Jalla decided who's strong enough for bigger trials and who's not. So the fact that some of us don't have as hard of a difficulty is because maybe Allah knows that we're not capable of handling any more than what He's given us. And some people have much more difficulty than we do. And we make dua for all of them. But today what I wanted to do is I was discussing an ayah actually with my wife earlier this week. And it just really struck me. I've never thought about this ayah for a long time. And what struck me about it is It's really a place in the Quran. By the way, this is Surah Al-A'raf, Surah number 7, and Ayah number 32. And anybody who's watching this also, and maybe even later on, please take note of it. Because it's one of those places in the Quran that kind of shapes the view of the world that you and I have. How are we supposed to see the world? And what, it's one of those fundamental places in the Quran that if you don't get it, you're missing out. You know, you're really, really missing out. And this is one of those places in the Quran. I really do think it deserves far more attention than it's gotten. So Allah says, قُلْ, tell them or declare. This is the Prophet being told to say قُلْ. Also, before I get to the ayah, it's important to note this ayah is right after Allah tells the story of Adam and Iblis. So the creation story has just been told in Surah Al-A'raf, and at the end of that comes this ayah. So we just learned that our father was, you know, the scheme of the devil to get him removed, you know, to get our parents' clothes removed and all of it, and then the warning to the children of Adam that he's going to try to mess with you the same way he messed with your parents, then comes this ayah. So it's an ayah not just for Muslims in a sense, it's for all of Allah's slaves, all of the children of Adam. So it's a universal ayah about all of humanity. So the Prophet is told to say, قُلْ, declare, pronounce. This is also important before I even go to the rest of the ayah, because sometimes Allah just says, sometimes He starts an ayah by saying, قُلْ. And قُلْ, which is easily translated as say, actually also means this is something you must go out of your way to announce. You must go out of your way to declare this, to pronounce this, to remind people of this. So sometimes Allah is talking to us directly, and sometimes He's even telling us through the sunnah of the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that this is one of those things that we have to bring up. We have to bring this into conversation. And that's captured inside just the word قُلْ. And that, in doing that, we are actually not only obeying Allah, we are reliving the legacy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in that he was told to say this and then announce this. So now we have the honor of announcing it. So we're actually mimicking something the Messenger of Allah did, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So those are special places in the Quran. When you see قُلْ, those are special places, because those are places Allah wants believers to have those conversations with each other. And not just by themselves, to declare them, to engage with them. Anyway, so what's the ayah? This ayah opens up with a threat. مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةَ اللَّهِ. Who dares to prohibit or make haram, if you will? Who dares to make haram? Now, before I finish that sentence, you would expect Allah will say, who dares to make haram what Allah made halal? That's a pretty understandable sentence. قُلْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ مَا أَحَلَّهُ اللَّهِ. Tell them, who dares to make haram what Allah made halal? But that's not what he said. Instead, he said, who dares to make haram zinat Allah? Which is translated, who dares to make haram Allah's beauty? Allah's beauty. It's a strange thing to even read that in English translation. A lot of English translations that Sheikh Suhaib and I went through some of them today, try to get around that because it sounds weird in English. Who dares to make haram Allah's beauty? So let's pause here for a second and understand this question itself. Why did Allah is the best speaker of all of us. So if He used this wording that sounds weird to us in English, there's a reason He did that. Because He's the one who taught us speech. He's the one who's عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ. He taught the human being the ability to speak clearly. Nobody speaks more clearly than Allah. So if He chose to speak this way, there's wisdom in it. There's a teaching in it. There's a purpose in it. So let's stop and think about the word beauty. Quran describes beauty in many places. Allah will describe that, you know, إِنَّ جَعَلْنَا مَعَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا. Many of you recited Surah Al-Kahf today. It's Friday. We put everything on this earth as a beauty for it. A beautification for it. So zina is used for the world. زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحِ in Surah Al-Mulk. We decorated the lowest sky with stars. You know, بِزِينَةِ الْكَوَاكِبِ, by the beauty of stars. Allah talks about the beauty of stars in the nighttime. So the word beauty is not just used in negative context, but it's also used in negative context. It's used by the devil. Allah says, well, you know, وَزَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ, the devil beautified their deeds for them. They were doing horrible things, but the devil made them look like they're doing something beautiful. So now we've got two opposites. You've got the devil, shaitan, trying to make something look beautiful. And on the flip side, you've got Allah saying there's something called Allah's beauty. Allah's beauty. Now, let's think about Allah's beauty for a moment. Allah says in a famous hadith, or the Prophet says about Allah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ. Certainly Allah is beautiful, He loves beauty. That's something Allah says about Himself. And human beings have always been attracted to beauty like no other creature on this planet. Birds don't make a more beautiful nest. They don't do that. Ants don't make a more beautiful home and say, no, I think we need to move the dirt over this way, the color scheme's off. They don't do that. Human beings do that. Human beings want to dress in nicer and nicer clothes. Human beings look at a beautiful car and stop. A car is just there to get you from A to B, but why are we so stunned by its shape and its color and its interior and its, you know, materials? We're obsessed with beauty in physical appearance. We're obsessed with beauty in our housing, in the rides that we ride in the shoes that we put on, in the clothes that we put on. We're obsessed with beauty in the things we look at. You want to go to a beautiful place. You see a picture, man, I want to go there one day, because you want to look at a beautiful place. You know, elephants don't have this issue. We do. No other creature has this issue, but Allah put this inside of us. And one of the ways to think about this is, we were in the presence of Allah Himself. Meaning we were in the presence of the most beautiful of all, from whom all beauty comes. And then Allah brought us to the earth. And when He brought us to the earth, there's a ruh inside us that has already seen Allah, talked to Allah. And that ruh has already experienced the ultimately beautiful. And now, because he's experienced and she's experienced that ultimately beautiful, we're just looking for beauty everywhere. And every time we find something beautiful, like a beautiful meal, like if food looks disgusting, you're not going to eat it. If it doesn't smell beautiful, if it doesn't look beautiful, you know, the beauty even in taste. Again, other species, they don't care about taste. They'll just eat, if it's nutrition, they'll eat it. You know, but human beings will. We want beauty in all things. And Allah says in this ayah, Allah's beauty. As if all things beautiful are only beautiful because they go back to Allah. They're a manifestation of Allah's own beauty. That's why if I asked even a young man or woman or anybody, even a non-Muslim or you know, a Christian or anybody else, I'm actually reminded one time I went to a waterfall and I met a Christian fellow who was handing out like articles on Jesus to tourists, right? And I was by a waterfall, and he looked at the waterfall and he said, I said, so what brought you here? He goes, I like looking at God's artwork. That's what he called it. And he's right, right? He's looking at something beautiful Allah has created, and he wants to appreciate it. That's why he comes there. Well, he really comes there to preach, but whatever. That's why he comes there. The point that I'm making is, when we think of things that Allah has made beautiful, you can think of an ocean or mountains or the beautiful night sky or the stars, or you can think of, you know, a beautiful baby. You can think of all kinds of things that are beautiful. But in this ayah, Allah has done something else. In this ayah, Allah has told us that the things that He made halal are actually a sign of Allah's beauty. The things that He made halal are actually a manifestation of Allah's beauty. Not just the mountains and the waterfalls and the skies and the moon and the... Not just that. The fact that He gave us halal, and whatever, if it's halal food, if it's marriage, if it's having a child through wedlock, if it's, you know, these things that Allah made halal, these things are actually Allah's beauty itself. And when someone is living within what Allah has made halal, then they appreciate not only that Allah has made this halal for them, but the halal things, because they are Allah's beauty, they make life beautiful. They actually, halal makes life beautiful. Everything around you starts becoming beautiful. Everything becomes, you know, something that reminds you of how beautiful Allah Himself is. This is a great gift Allah gave us. By the way, this, I told you, it's the story of Adam alayhi salam in the beginning, right? And in the beginning, before even the story, Allah said He put you on this earth and put all kinds of luxuries here for you. How little you show gratitude. Sure, He put luxuries here for us. But now He's telling us the thing that makes this world beautiful, truly beautiful, is actually that which He made permissible. And then He asked the question, I went out, and He didn't stop there. He said, Allati akhraja li'ibadihi. The beauty of Allah that He brought out for His servants. Meaning, here servants means all of humanity. You can think of it that way. He brought the halal, the beautiful in the halal, out for all of His servants, for everybody. But he didn't just say He created it, or He declared it. He said, akhraja. to bring out, to pull out. Now the thing is, you know, diamonds aren't just lying around. You have to dig through rock and you have to unearth it, and then you have to refine it before you find its beauty. It has to be brought out. The most beautiful plants have to be brought out of the earth before they blossom. The idea is that this beauty was buried and hidden away and you would have never known it. It's Allah who brought it out and went out of his way to bring it out so his servants could enjoy something beautiful. And he does all this for you, and then somebody comes along and says, what Allah has made halal, I have a problem with. I don't like it. I have an issue with it. As if we determine what is right and it's not even we determine what's right and wrong. Allah is offended in this ayah, angry in this ayah, at those who take what Allah has made halal and somehow criticize it, somehow think it's prohibited or unacceptable, because they're not just questioning Allah's authority, they're denying the beauty of Allah. That's what they're actually doing. How? It's as if you saw the beautiful creation of Allah and called it ugly. Oh, what's this? How defiant could you be? You know? And that's the question that this ayah begins with. But then it takes a turn. He says, this beauty of Allah that he brought out for his servants, وَالطَّيِّبَاتِ مِنَ الرِّزْقِ, and over and above that, good and pure things from all kinds of provision, I brought those out for you too. You can think of this as an explanatory note, meaning the beauty of Allah could be, you know, because the previous passage is also about clothing, you know, and it's also about, you know, other things. It's about Adam and Hawa, and it's about them covering themselves. And then he says, I made clothing for you to make it beautiful. There are two things that are beautiful. It's the relationship between Adam and Hawa and the covering of the human being. Those are beautiful. And he says, who dares to make that ugly? And by the way, I didn't just give you that. I gave you all kinds of tayyibat, good and pure things, of all kinds of rizq. If you study the tayyibat in the Quran, they have to do with our relationships, and they have to do with food and drink and the things that we consume. They have to do with those things. He says, anybody's going to criticize what I made beautiful, what I made pure, what I gave to my servants? And then he says again in the ayah, قُلْ, this is all one ayah, just ayah 32. He says, قُلْ, tell them. The ayah began already with قُلْ. Then he says again, قُلْ, هِيَا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. It's as if Allah says, tell them again. Say it again, pronounce again, reaffirm. Reaffirm what? هِيَا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. These, meaning these good and pure things, these manifestations of Allah's beauty, are for those who have come to faith in this worldly life. As if Allah is saying, tell them these are Allah's gifts for people who came to Allah. These are Allah, the ones you're criticizing are Allah's gifts that he gave to people who chose to believe in him. هِيَا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. And then he adds, خَالِصَةً يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. It didn't even stop there. Tell them these are gifts from Allah that he brought for his servants, in this, his those who believe in him, in this life. And then he said, but these gifts are going to be pure for them on Judgment Day. Purely for them. Meaning, right now, even things that are halal are accessible to believer and non-believer. But when Judgment Day comes, after that, these gifts of Allah will only be for believers. There's something to pause. There's three things to note here. I hope I get through all three. I know I'm over my time, but I want to get through all three. The first of them is that Allah wasn't talking about heaven, was he? He was talking about this life. He was talking about things that we enjoy because Allah made them halal and brought them out for us in this life. But then all of a sudden, he started talking about what we're going to get in Jannah. That only believers will get. But I thought what we're going to get in Jannah is totally different from what we get here. But he said, no, these are for believers in this life and purely for them in the next life. But the question arises, but if this is purely for them in the next life, but I thought the next life has different stuff. Not this stuff again. Allah is telling us that what he made halal in this world, listen to this carefully now, what he made halal in this world is actually a preview of what he's about to give in Jannah. The only difference is, it's not pure here. What does that mean, it's not pure here? It doesn't come without trials. So even the things that Allah has made halal for us here, they don't come without trials. They come with some difficulty. Even the halal comes with difficulty. But when you come before Allah as a faithful person on Judgment Day, then He will give you the same halal, but it will not have any trials. It will have no difficulties. But the same thing will be there, but it will have no difficulty. Subhanallah. Khalid, that's one meaning. Another meaning is only believers will have it. Right now, first of all, he said, I brought this out for all my slaves, but actually, my real intent was to make this world beautiful by way of the halal for those who show me appreciation by believing in me. And that's why I will take special care of them in Akhirah. I'll take special care of them in the Akhirah. And it's khalisatan yawm al-qiyamah, the idea that Allah will make these things pure for us on Resurrection Day means we have already been given a taste of what's coming. If a believer becomes grateful to Allah, then they have a taste of what's coming in Jannah. Here's the last thing I'll share with you. This is Ibn Ashur rahimahullah said this, or Alusi rahimahullah said this is beautiful. He said, you know how Allah says, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ, you will be questioned about all the blessings, right? Every food, every bite you ate, you'll be asked about. But this ayah is telling us something else. When a believer stays inside the halal, when they stay inside the halal, then that act itself is gratitude. And they can just have it purely on Judgment Day, meaning they don't have to have it by having to answer for any of them. This is why the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ will describe that when someone eats halal, consumes halal, enjoys halal, that itself is an act of worship, yes? That itself is an act of worship. For anyone who doesn't have iman, when they enjoy those same things, they will be asked about those blessings. But for someone who has iman, knowingly, with their heart, they know, I am enjoying this blessing because Allah has made it what? Halal for me. That mindset, that place in your heart itself is an act of gratitude. Khalisatan yawm al-qiyamah. And then finally he adds, this is the conclusion of the ayah, كَذَلِكَ نُفَصِّلُ الْآيَاتِ لِقَوْمٍ يَعْلَمُونَ, that is how we explain the ayat for people who want to know. That conclusion, I'll take 5 minutes and I'm done, I promise. That is how we explain ayat for people who want to know. Yeah, because قَوْم is nakira, يَعْلَمُونَ is a mudari. I'll get technical for a second. When a mudari comes as a sifa, it's not the act. Some translations say the people who know. It's actually يَعْلَمُونَ actually becomes a kind of an incomplete verb. They're trying to know. They want to know. Not just a nation who knows. A nation who wants to know. This is important because Allah is telling us a lot of people don't want to know. But the lesson in this ayah is only for people who actually care to know. So there are some people who are what you can call know-it-alls. I already know it. I don't need to hear this. I already know. I don't care. What am I referring to? What the shaitan does, I told you shaitan, in this khutbah earlier when I said shaitan also beautifies deeds. And now I'm telling you Allah beautifies what? Halal? Shaitan's job is to somehow convince humanity, believer, unbeliever, Muslim, non-Muslim, doesn't matter. His job is to convince everyone that the halal is ugly. Find some ugliness in the halal. And be completely quiet or okay or even celebrate the what? Haram. And the way to do that, you can do both. You can, you know, in some cases he takes ugly things that are clearly filthy. Because the only things Allah made haram are things that are khabith. يُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ. Filthy things He made haram. And He will make them look glorified. Like it's progress. Like we're modern now. Like we're moving forward in humanity. We're evolved somehow. We are advanced. We are forward thinking. These are nice words for ugly things. But on the flip side, the shaitan will do something else. The shaitan will take what is halal, and he will make some people say that's backwards. He'll make some people say that's unfair. He'll make some people think that their own moral standards the ones that don't have anything to do with Allah and His Messenger, their own moral standards, are higher than what Allah made halal and haram. So if you culturally don't like something, but Allah is okay with it, then your culture is above what Allah is okay with, you'll call it ugly anyway, even though it's halal. And I already told you, when you call something Allah made halal ugly, when you criticize it, then you're criticizing the beauty of Allah. That's what the devil wants. He doesn't want you to see the beauty in what Allah made. He wants things that Allah made beautiful to appear ugly. And the things that Allah tells you are ugly to look beautiful. That's his job. So now ask yourself, and I ask myself, Muslims from around the world, forget non-Muslims even, Muslims from around the world, how often is it that in our cultures, there are things, there are standards that stand against what is halal? And when somebody does or consumes something that is halal, then we stand as our culture and say, that's not okay because we don't do things that way. And the answer from them is, but it's halal. Yeah, but that doesn't make it okay. Says who? Well, says my grandmother. Says the place, the village I came from. Says everybody around me. Everybody knows. No, everybody on one side. Everybody, if all of humanity gathered and said something is not okay, and Allah says it's okay, and it's good for you, then they're all wrong. All of them are wrong. That none of that matter. All of those opinions will come and go. But what we have created for ourselves is a false sense of right and wrong. And that false sense is keeping us from seeing the beauty of Allah in this life. Many times when our cultures or our own standards go against what Allah says, and we create our own halal and haram, that's what it is really, our own expectations of right and wrong, when we do that, that contradicts Allah's, then we create ugliness in our families, in our communities, in our society, in our speech, inside of ourselves. Ugliness spreads because that's what the devil wants. And when we celebrate that which is halal, when we honor it as something that Allah brought out for his servants, that he gave as a preview of Jannah. By the way, I emphasize it's a preview of Jannah. Why? Because when someone criticizes the halal, then it's almost as though they're criticizing, you know, if somebody watched a preview, I'll give you a terrible example, preview of a movie, and they don't like the trailer, that means they don't like the what? They don't like the movie. So if somebody's criticizing the halal now, and Allah says this is only a teaser for what's coming in Jannah, do you realize that criticizing the halal now is actually criticizing what Allah has prepared for His believers in Jannah? It's like, your Jannah, no, I don't agree with that. Not really. Heaven, no thanks. This is the eye-opener that this ayah is. This is one ayah, but it's, you know, if you really put, you know, yourself and people around you and the things you hear for yourself or others around you and your family, whatever, everybody's life story is different, and you gauge whether or not we see what Allah wants us to see, or are we seeing things the way the devil wants us to see them? It becomes a really difficult thing. For myself and yourself, for ourselves, first, before anybody else, for our own selves. May Allah Azza wa Jal let us see the truth for the truth and give us the courage to follow it, and let us see the false as false and give us the courage to get away from it. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن الحكيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله.
استقيم الله.
الله أكبر.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. إن الذين قالوا ربنا الله ثم استقاموا تتنزل عليهم الملائكة ألا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا وأبشروا بالجنة التي كنتم توعدون. نحن أولياؤكم في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة، ولكم فيها ما تشتهي أنفسكم ولكم فيها ما تدعون، نزلا من غفور رحيم. ومن أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا وقال إنني من المسلمين. ولا تستوي الحسنة ولا السيئة، ادفع بالتي هي أحسن فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. وما يلقاها إلا الذين صبروا وما يلقاها إلا ذو حظ عظيم. وإما ينزغنك من الشيطان نزغ فاستعذ بالله، إنه هو السميع العليم. الله. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر، إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.